Hello everyone, this is Dr. Sanjana. Today I'm going to present a journal from Lancet which was published online on April 23, 2020, titled Practical Recommendations for the Management of Diabetes in Patients with COVID-19. My moderator is Dr. Samaga sir. Introduction. From January 2020, we have been facing an unprecedented outbreak of COVID-19 caused by novel coronavirus SARS-CoV-2. We all know that the outcome of infection in coronavirus is severe in patients with comorbidities, namely diabetes, hypertension, and cardiovascular diseases. Diabetes is one of the most important comorbidities linked to the severity of all the three known human pathogenic coronavirus infections, including SARS-CoV-2. Patients with diabetes have an increased risk of severe complications, including ARDS and multi-organ failure. Studies have also shown that COVID-19 is associated with hyperglycemia, particularly in elderly with type 2 diabetes. Globally, 20-50% of the patients in COVID-19 pandemic had diabetes. Given this importance of link between COVID-19 and diabetes, and an international panel of experts from the field of diabetes and endocrinology have provided guidance and practical recommendations for the management of diabetes, which has been outlined in the current article. Potential links between diabetes and COVID-19 infection. Diabetes is a primary risk factor for the development of severe pneumonia and septic course due to virus infections and occurs in about 20% of the patients. Diabetes was identified as a major contributor to the disease severity and mortality in Middle East respiratory syndrome infection. Evidence from epidemiological observations and other national health centers shows that the risk of fatal outcome from COVID-19 is up to 50% higher in patients with diabetes than in those who do not have diabetes. So why do diabetics have severe COVID infections? Diabetics have defective innate immunity affecting phagocytosis, neutrophil chemotaxis, and also cell-mediated immunity, which poses them the higher risk of infection. Diabetics in elderly is also associated with cardiovascular disease, which explains the association of fatal outcomes of COVID-19. As we all know, the ACE2 receptor, which is angiotensin converting enzyme receptor, is a receptor for coronavirus spike protein. So depending on the various pathophysiological mechanisms and intricate factors involved, the COVID-19 can reduce ACE2 expression or cause upregulation of ACE2. So when COVID-19 reduces ACE2 expression, it causes cellular damage, hyperinflammation, and respiratory failure. Acute hyperglycemia upregulates ACE2 expression on cells, which facilitates virus entry. However, chronic hyperglycemia downregulates ACE2 expression, making cells vulnerable to inflammatory and damaging effects of virus. ACE2 expression on the pancreatic beta cells also leads to direct effect on beta cell function, so because of which they can induce a new onset diabetes. So diabetes might not only be a risk factor for severe COVID, but also can induce a new onset diabetes, which is supported by frequent cases of diabetic ketoacidosis and tremendous requirement of insulin in patients with severe COVID infection. The extent of insulin resistance in diabetics is disproportionate compared to the critical illness caused by other infections. So other mechanism which is implicated is the involvement of DPP-4. So which was described in Middle East respiratory syndrome. DPP-4 or dipeptidyl peptidase 4 was recognized as a functional receptor for the MERS virus. DPP-4 enzyme plays an important role in glucose and insulin metabolism, also increases inflammation in type 2 diabetes. But whether this applies to COVID-19 and whether DPP-4 inhibitors provide therapeutic opportunities in COVID is highly debatable. This table outlines the recommendations for the management of COVID-19 and metabolic disease, which includes also the management of hypertension and cholesterol. In outpatient care, patients should be sensitized for the importance of optimal metabolic control. They should be urged not to discontinue any established therapy. Also, they should be given an opportunity of telemedicine and connected health models in order to manage their current regimen and also to maintain maximal self-containment. In case of ICU or inpatient settings, we have to monitor for the new onset diabetes in the infected patients, also to manage infected patients with diabetes. So regular monitoring of glucose electrolytes and pH, blood ketones or beta hydroxybutyrate should be done. There should be liberal indication for early intravenous insulin therapy in severe courses like ARDS, hyperinflammation. For exact titration, avoid variable subcutaneous absorption and management of commonly seen very high insulin consumption in COVID infections. The therapeutic aims should be to manage glucose concentration in the range of 72 to 144 mg per dL and HbA1c of less than 7%. However, in ICU settings, the glucose can be maintained in the range of 72 to 180 mg per dL. This table outlines the potential metabolically interfering effects of drugs in suspected or COVID-19 positive patients with type 2 diabetes. Metformin, dehydration and lactic acidosis will probably occur if patients are dehydrated. Hence, metformin has to be stopped and renal function tests have to be monitored for risk of CKD or acute kidney injury. Sodium glucose co-transporter 2 inhibitors, that is SGLT2 inhibitors like canagliflozin, dapagliflozin and empagliflozin, increases the risk of dehydration and diabetic ketoacidosis during the illness. Hence, these drugs have to be stopped. Patients should avoid initiating therapy during respiratory illness, and again RFT has to be monitored for acute kidney injury. Glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor agonist like exenatide, liraglutide causes dehydration in serious illness, so they have to be closely monitored and adequate fluid intake and regular meals should be encouraged. Dipeptidyl peptidase 4 inhibitors, DPP4 inhibitors, namely saxagliptin, sitagliptin, linagliptin are well tolerated generally and should be continued. Insulin therapy should not be stopped. Regular self-monitoring of blood glucose every 2 to 4 hours should be encouraged or continuous glucose monitoring is advised. Carefully adjust regular therapy if appropriate to reach the therapeutic goals according to diabetes type, comorbidities and health status. Connected health models and telemedicine should be used to continue regular reviews and self-management education programs virtually and to ensure patients are adherent to therapy. But importantly, one thing to notice is discontinuing any of the drugs is not recommended prophylactically for OP patients with diabetes without any symptoms of infection or in the absence of evidence for a serious course of COVID-19. Management of hypertension in COVID patients. Whether antihypertensives like ACE inhibitors and ARBs to be continued or not. There are a few studies in the recent past which have showed the deleterious effect of use of ACE inhibitors and ARBs in COVID patients. This is because these drugs block the ACE2 receptors, which in turn will cause upregulation of more ACE2 receptors, which will cause more entry of virus into the cells and more severe infections. But however, there are no convincing evidences for it. So currently the present article strongly recommend the continuation of antihypertensive drugs, namely ACE inhibitors and ARBs. This is endorsed by the European Society of Cardiology and Heart Failure Society of America, American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association. So coming to the use of statins, statins should be continued because of their pleiotropic anti-inflammatory effect because they upregulate ACE2. Statins have to be continued for long-term benefits and to prevent cytokine storm. If statins are stopped, they upregulate interleukin-6 and interleukin-1 beta, which will precipitate cytokine storm. Also, patients with diabetes also have a concomitant fatty liver disease, which will probably increase the risk of inflammatory response, the so-called cytokine storm. So these patients have to be screened for hyperinflammation using ferritin, highly sensitive C-reactive protein, ESR. So any of these are increased, the immunosuppressant should be used, which can improve the outcome in COVID patients. Coming to obesity. Obesity determines lung volumes, respiratory mechanics, oxygenation during mechanical ventilation, especially during supine position. So obesity is a chronic low-grade inflammatory state which has impaired innate and adaptive immunity. There is increase in pro-inflammatory leptin levels, there is decrease in anti-inflammatory adiponectin levels and insulin resistance. So the obesity also has to be taken care of in diabetic patients. And when a healthcare worker has diabetes, they should be deployed away from frontline clinical duties, or if not possible, they have to be provided with a standardized proper PPE. Coming to insulin requirement in COVID patients. Given the multiple stresses associated with COVID-19, the defects in insulin secretion and frequent occurrence of diarrhea and sepsis, most of these patients have to be given insulin, and that too in very high requirements. Thus, they have to be given intravenous infusion of insulin. Second is to maintain fluid balance. So, to prevent dehydration, they should be hydrated to a minimal level. But at the same time, care should be taken not to overburden them with fluids, because it can exacerbate pulmonary edema in a severely inflamed lung. Then management of hypokalemia. One of the pathophysiology of coronavirus infection involves hyperaldosteronism. So this will cause sodium and water retention, in turn causes low potassium, causing hypokalemia. Also, when a patient with diabetes is treated with insulin, this also precipitates hypokalemia. Thus, the hypokalemia has to also be parallelly treated with the potassium supplements in addition to the treatment of diabetes with insulin. Surgical treatment of type 2 diabetes, metabolic surgery. It is advised to postpone elective metabolic surgery in order to provide beds for the IP patients of COVID. But also in obese and diabetics, there is increased risk of COVID complications, which can compound the negative influence of surgical stress during recovery. Also, most of these metabolic surgeries are laparotomies, which involves the development of pneumoperitoneum, which is a virus aerosolization procedure, so which can pose a risk to the treating doctors and the nurses. So, hence, elective surgery has to be avoided. Also, metabolic surgery induces mineral deficiencies, which by impairing absorption of the minerals can impair immunity. So all these recommendations which are put forth in the present articles are based on expert opinion, awaiting the outcome of randomized controlled trials, investigating subgroups with diabetes, and how these relate to COVID-19 outcomes will be important. In particular, investigating if some of the various management approaches would be particularly effective in managing diabetes in COVID-19 context. Coming to related articles. Telemedicine for Diabetes Care in India during COVID-19 pandemic and national lockdown period. Guidelines for physicians. They concluded that telemedicine is a useful tool for managing patients of diabetes during this lockdown period. However, there is limited data and further research is required in this regard. Another article titled Diabetes in COVID-19, Prevalence, Pathophysiology, Prognosis and Practical Considerations. They concluded that there is an evidence of increased incidence and severity of COVID-19 in diabetics, and COVID-19 could have effect on the pathophysiology of diabetes. Blood glucose control is important not only for patients who are infected with COVID-19, but also for those without the disease. They also recommended the use of telemedicine to treat patients with diabetes in today's lockdown period. Thank you.